Hell no. Watching Blues again? No.
Mm-hmm. It gets into good stuff later.
What did she say?
She's advanced. She's been here for like 30 years.
They haven't really beaten anybody of substance. And the other team's wiping everybody out, but no.
Can I have a copy of that too?
How many times have they been down there? They can take it.
Who is it?
Three or four.
Eli.
Yeah.
That's a name.
Yeah.
The country.
I don't know, but I drove by it, Tom. At least three.
They're big.
They never won. They never came close to winning.
Oh, it's cost to get in.
1500, yeah, it is a ticket, yeah, but.
So I don't know what people down say. I, you know, and maybe this is their year. I don't know.
Do you want to report?
No, I don't watch. I don't, Roberts and I are, yeah, well, because we've competed. I had a kids team against his kids team for years, and we beat them more often than not. And one year, I had a pretty good team, and we beat them to go to the All-Star playoffs. And it was kind of, it was Whitcomb, one of his kids. But what was funny is they had a slow pitcher. We couldn't hit him. And they replaced it with their ace closer.
I feel like it was shifted over.
We were fastball hitting team. And he was mad because I was nailing him. I said, no, you.
I think this is it, right?
Because the pitcher,
we missed anybody? All right.
You screwed up. And of course, he didn't do that.
Is it a meeting? Do I call a meeting?
That's what I do. But my kids and his kids have always came through the ranks together. And I was always a traitor because I was Valpo and he was Washington. You know, I was up there.
Is that the way to go? All right. We'll call this, I don't know if it's meeting or order. If everybody could rise.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'm going to do a roll call. Just, she's going to keep minutes.
Okay, Councilmember Rivas.
Here.
Councilmember Bozick.
Here.
Councilmember Brickner.
Here.
Councilmember Graham.
Here.
Whatever you want, man.
Councilmember Jessen.
Yes.
Councilmember Paparai and Councilmember Sims.
Present and accounted for.
Okay, so I think everybody knows we're here with, this is Paige from Baker Tilly. We hired Baker Tilly to help us with some, you know, budgeting stuff and a financial plan and capital plan and some budget stuff. So this is part of what they're doing. This is a little budget workshop just to kick things off. So Paige, I'll turn it over to you. No, I think it should be on, I think. Is it?
I don't know. I don't think people can hear me. Does this need to be on?
Yeah, we can turn it on.
It's on.
Okay.
It's an on.
Okay. All right, so yeah, the purpose of my presentation this evening is to kind of give you a budget 101. And if you're a really seasoned person, this is all probably gonna be repeat information. But I gotta tell you, we do this for a lot of municipalities and counties all over the state. It's a really a good refresher right before you go into budget season. So I'm gonna go through that. And then I'm gonna talk about maybe a new way of thinking in relation to how you prepare your budgets. And again, we do this a lot with counties. It's really basically starts with estimating the revenues first and then building your budgets off of that. But that'll be towards the end. So I'll go ahead and get started. And please, I'm happy to take questions throughout. So we're just gonna start with some very basic concepts, and I may not read directly off the slide, hopefully I don't, but there's a couple of reasons why we do annual budgets here in the state of Indiana. One is that it's required by statute. We have to. That is the way that you get your certified appropriation. In other words, this is how you get permission to spend the money that you have. Without appropriation, you cannot spend the money that you have. There's a few exceptions to that. Number two, it's the way that the counties get the property tax rate in order to prepare the tax bills. So this whole statutory process is a way to, number one, get your certified appropriations, permission to spend, and then also this is how we get the property tax rates in order to generate those tax bills, and the tax bills are what generates the property tax revenue for you to operate. So there's two state agencies that people often get confused. One is the Department of Local Government Finance, DLGF. That is the state agency that approves approves the budgets, the property tax levies, and the property tax rates. In addition, they oversee our property tax assessment process here in the state of Indiana. So really, they are just on the side of approving your budget and approving assessments. The State Board of Accounts, on the other hand, that is the state agency that comes in and audits your books. So you can kind of think of it this way, that the DLGF approves the authority for you to spend, and then the State Board of Accounts comes behind that and looks at your actual expenditures and if you follow the accounting policies and procedures. Another important thing that you need to know is that there is a transparency portal here in the state of Indiana. It's called the Indiana Gateway for Governmental Units. This is a great tool for not only members of local government, but also the public as well, and anybody really doing any type of research. I'm probably in Gateway every single day because it has so much data, not just on your county, but on any taxing unit in the state of Indiana. So you could go in there and do comparisons, like salary comparisons, look at other counties' budgets, what are they budgeting, for instance, in highway and the sheriff's department, et cetera. So there's kind of two ways you can get into Gateway. One is just the public access, so anybody can get in there. But there's another way that you can get in, and that's by getting a special login. And the county auditor has that special login, but she could designate others to get in there as well if she wanted to. But that is kind of the two ways to get into Gateway. And again, it has so much valuable information. So property taxes are based on net assessed value. And that really is our tax base here in Indiana. It is the net value after we take out deductions, abatements, and tax increment finance areas. So it's important that you know that our tax base is net assessed value, not gross. And I'll have an example here in just a minute. The property tax levy is the dollars generated by applying our tax rate to each $100 of assessed value. Many states have like a millage rate where it's applied to each $1,000 of assessed value. But here in Indiana, it's applied to each $100 of assessed value. So in other words, if we're trying to figure out how much property tax levy a certain rate can generate, you're gonna apply that tax rate to the net assessed value divided by 100. So this is an example of net assessed value, and sometimes taxpayers don't fully understand this. So, you know, if you were talking about a rate increase, let's say it's 2 cents, a taxpayer might apply that 2 cents to their gross assessed value if it was like a $100,000 home value. But that really isn't the correct way to do that, because we are fortunate here in Indiana that we have a pretty good standard deduction and mortgage deduction and homestead deduction. So if I have a gross assessed residential homestead of $100,000, I'm only paying taxes on $32,750 usually. So what I get is a standard deduction of $45,000 right off the top. Then I get another 35% supplemental homestead deduction on top of that. And then if you have a mortgage, you get $3,000. So the point is, the tax rate for this particular property is going to go on the $32,750, not the $100,000. So every taxing unit in the state has a maximum amount of property tax that it is allowed to raise. So even if you wanted to raise, you know, $50 million or whatever it might be, you are capped. And that maximum rate, or that maximum levy, it's not a maximum rate, the maximum levy was set back in the late 1970s. And it's been growing by a relatively small growth factor every year. 10 years ago, it changed so that every single taxing unit in the state gets the same levy growth factor, annual growth factor. And it's based on a six-year average of non-farm personal income. So you're probably thinking, what the heck is that? That really is just, it just means that it's based on income that's not farm related. So it really is affected by changes in the economy. So as we experience a good economy, those annual maximum levy growth factors tend to go up. Now, the statute has those capped at 6%. In my time, which has been over 20 years doing this, I've not seen it anywhere close to 6%. So just to give you some perspective, currently this year, your maximum levy grew by 4.2%. So you can imagine if your costs are growing by a margin that's more than that, or a percentage that's more than that, that's where we tend to see budget deficits. In 2020, it was only 3.5%. We think that in 2022, it might be as much as 4.4%. We're waiting for that certification. That's gonna come out from the DLGF probably later this month. But it may start to go back down because it is based on a six-year average, and we know we had some COVID influences there in 2020. So again, not a whole lot of growth for your primary revenue source. So that brings me to some very important things that you need to know, that annual growth factor, as I stated before, is a formula that's derived from the statute. It doesn't matter how much your population is growing here in this county or any other county, how much your property values are growing, what your development is doing, or even how much you're spending. It's not based on that. You could submit a budget of zero, nothing, and still get your maximum levy as long as you advertise or post on Gateway and adopt correctly. And people sometimes have a hard time wrapping their heads around that concept, but it is a certified number. It doesn't matter how much you're spending or how much you want to spend or how much you're growing. So that's why we see some communities, especially communities that are growing at a rapid pace, they're struggling because that annual levy growth factor is not keeping up with the pace of growth. So this is just this is Porter County specific. So for 2021, you've got kind of two groups of levies. So I just talked about the maximum levy, and that's your controlled levy. That's the levy that has that growth factor every year. So your maximum controlled levy is pretty close to $42 million. And within that $42 million, you have four different funds: general, reassessment, cumulative bridge, and health. During the budget season, you can decide to shift levy from the control funds, except for CUME Bridge. That is a rate-driven fund, which is a whole other issue. But let's just say you needed more levy in the health fund, for instance. You could shift from general to health. So you have the ability to allocate those levies as you need to, but only during the budget process. Once the budget order is certified, you cannot change it after that. Now, there are ways to generate property tax above and beyond that maximum levy, and that would be, you're taking advantage of that. It would be a cumulative capital development fund, number one, and number two, any sort of debt issuance. So it could be general obligation bonds or a lease rental bond like you have. So you can generate monies outside the max by utilizing those methods. So here's another example that's specific to Porter County, just to show you kind of your makeup of not only your net assessed value, which is a $10.5 billion, but also the property tax rates you're charging to generate almost $47 million all in when you include even the non-control funds. So your tax rate of 0.4452 applied to the $10.5 billion is gonna generate about 47,000, that's gross before we add in circuit breakers, which is something I'm gonna cover here in a minute.
47 million.
So here's another concept that sometimes is a little bit hard to grasp, is that correlation between net assessed values and tax rates. So it's important to know that if your assessed value, your tax base, those property values go down, then it's gonna take a higher tax rate to generate your maximum levy. Vice versa, if your assessed values go up, that could drive your rate down. Now, what some people often think is that, oh, our property values are going up, so we're gonna collect more property taxes. And that's not the case, because remember, you're capped. So all it's going to do is if your assessed value goes up, your tax rate's gonna come down and you're gonna collect that maximum levy that you're allowed to collect. So then I have an example of if you have a maximum levy of $2 million and a $500 million tax base, it takes 40 cents to generate that. So then what happens if your tax base in scenario two goes up to $550 million? You still are maxed at that $2 million maximum levy. It's just gonna take a lower rate, 36 cents, to generate that 2 million. So you're not collecting any more property tax, it's just lowering your tax rate. Now, obviously there could be circumstances where this would help your circuit breaker. So by lowering circuit breaker credits, you could potentially collect more. But generally speaking, this is how that works, how that correlation works. And then here's another example. Now this has to do with your CUME Capital Development Fund, which is outside the levy limits. So it's outside the levy limits, so it's capped with a specific rate. So rate cap funds can sometimes get an increase in levy if your tax base goes up. So here we just have an example of, let's say your CCD fund rate is 3.31 cents, which could never be here. This is really a maximum for a municipal CCD fund rate. But if it was 3.31 cents on $500 million of assessed value, that would generate about $166,000. But if the tax base goes up, you could potentially generate more tax dollars. You might have to reestablish the rate. But that's the difference between a non-controlled rate that's outside the levy and then controlled, which is just you're maxed out. You can't raise anymore. The next concept I want to cover is...
We just skipped this section. We don't talk about income taxes in the county. I'm just kidding.
I really wanted to talk about this one, though. Okay, so local income tax. This is a tax on your adjusted gross income, and it's based on the county in which you live, not work. So that's important to know. There's different types of local income tax here in the state. There's a property tax relief income tax. There's an expenditure kind of bucket is what I'll call it, and then a special purpose income tax. Here in this county, you just have the economic development income tax. But there's also certified shares that could be deposited in the general fund and used for any purpose. There's public safety income tax that can be used for any public safety purpose. And then a correctional facility tax that's usually used to pay for jail improvements, upgrades, buildings, et cetera. So you are the second lowest local income tax rate in the state. I believe Jefferson County is the lowest. And then you tie with Warrick County for being the second lowest. But that said, there's also an opportunity if you need it at some time in the future to think about adopting or increasing any of those rates if you need additional work. All right, circuit breaker credits. This is a confusing concept. I mean, the state certainly doesn't make this easy to understand. But so around 2010, our state passed circuit breaker tax credits. And these are great for taxpayers because as a taxpayer, it limits how much you can pay on your tax bill. That's great. So no matter what you do as a county or no matter what the city does, you are limited by certain percentages based on your property type. So what happens is the county calculates your tax bill. And if it's above the circuit breaker cap, they will issue a credit. So if I'm a taxpayer and I see one of those credits on my bill, that means I'm not paying my full bill. Had we not had circuit breaker, I would have paid something more. But since I'm not paying that credit, that is property tax you are not receiving. So you levy a certain amount of money, but you don't collect it all because of those circuit breaker credits. So it really is, I'm gonna just say unpaid property tax. That's really what it is. So here are the different classifications of property tax caps. We have the homestead, which we call 1% property, so that's, you know, your primary residence on up to 1 acre of land. So if you had a gross assessed value, homestead value, then you'd be maxed at $1,000. Now, there are exceptions, like there is for everything. If you have a school in your area that had a referendum and you voted positively that they're allowed to go ahead and issue debt for some big project, then you have to pay the rate above and beyond the cap for that debt because it was referendum debt. The second type of property tax cap is what we call 2% property, and that would cover other residential rental, so the rental properties, agricultural land, and long-term care facilities. So that's capped at 2%. It's got a higher cap. And then everything else, which would include primarily commercial, but industrial and real and personal property, and that's capped at 3%. So again, that has a higher cap. So just as an example, I pulled, I looked to see what your highest district tax rate was in this county. And that would be Hebron Taxing District. That's your highest district rate. So I knew I would be able to show a circuit breaker example here. So in this example, I have residential home value of $200,000. So the cap should be $2,000, unless there's a referendum. And in fact, there was a referendum in this taxing district. So after we apply all the deductions, the taxable portion of that property is only $97,750 after I apply all the deductions. So if I divide that by 100 and multiply it by the tax bill for that tax district, I get a tax bill of $3,170. But again, I told you I can't pay more than $2,000, so I get a credit of $1,170. That's not what I'm not paying, and that's what the taxing units are not receiving in this district. But I do have to pay the exempt rates, which would be that school referendum. So my total tax bill is $2,205. So this may help you understand why some taxpayers may say, I'm paying more than $2,000, and I've got a residential home value of $200,000. Why am I paying more than the cap? My question to them would be, well, was there a school referendum in your taxing district? Is that why? Because if it is, then you do have to pay that portion. That's not exempt from circuit breaker. But again, if we didn't have property tax caps, then you would have got the full tax bill, or the full tax bill would have been allocated to the taxing units of the taxing district. So once the circuit breakers are identified, here's how they're allocated, and it's really based on each unit's tax rate to the total district rate. So Hebron Taxing District has a total district rate of 3.2433 for 2021. So if you just look down here, Boone Township School Corporation is the largest rate of that district rate. It's 59% of that total district rate. So they are going to get allocated the largest portion of that circuit breaker loss. So the loss was $1,170. I shouldn't say loss. The non-collection of property tax was $1,170. They're going to get 59% of that, so $692. So this is kind of important to see because all these units kind of work together. So even if you didn't increase your rate, and let's say the town or the school or the library increase its tax rate, guess what? Your circuit breaker is going to go up just because the whole district is going up. So that's something to be aware of. So this again is 2021, Porter County specific. I showed you all of what you're levying. It's about $47 million, but that's not what you're going to collect, because DLGF has certified that your circuit breakers will be a little over $2 million, so $2.1 million. So that's gonna come off. I mean, it's not gonna come off, it's just not gonna be collected. So your net tax receipts are gonna be about $44.7 million. So you are not collecting about 4.5% roughly of what you levy. Looking at it another way, if we were pre-circuit breaker before 2010, you'd have an additional $2.1 million that you could use for your operating costs. And this is just a graphical representation of that, where you you know, the blue part of this graph is the net. Although you're levying about 47 million, you're not going to be collecting all that. You're only going to collect about 44.7, and that doesn't even include, we don't know what delinquencies might be out there, because that would also obviously be a non-collection. But fortunately, I say fortunately because I work with a lot of counties where the non-collection rate is a lot higher. So, and I think the reason why yours isn't so high is because your assessed value has been growing over the years. And so that tends to keep those circuit breakers down. So you're about 4.5%. Some counties I work with are much higher, 10, 15%. It just varies all over the state.
I guess I'll just jump in real quick. This is why the really difficult, what she just went through very well, is the hard thing to enunciate at a meeting of why, even though the tax rate is X, why additional AV ends up helping. Because it seems counterintuitive, because as you bring AV up and the tax rate then goes down, it helps on the circuit breaker money that is basically disappearing. So as you raise that AV, so that's why that continued action to try to raise the AV as much as possible drives the tax rate down, but reduces or begins to reduce the amount of money that basically disappears from tax caps. So that's, these are really good slides that tell you exactly how it works, but that's a difficult concept that feels like it's counterintuitive.
So now we're just going to talk a little bit about the budget making process. Again, this may be pretty easy information for you, but it's a good refresher. So we do have to start with the net assessed values, and the county works on those property values, and they certify them to the Department of Local Government Finance, and the due date is August 1st, but sometimes that doesn't always happen. We usually get them through August and sometimes into September. But that's really just determining our property values. And we're on a cyclical system of assessment here in the state, meaning 25% of properties get assessed, you know, each year. So it really helps, because then we don't have huge increases or decreases in the assessed value. If you remember a few years ago, I think it was every 5 or 10 years, and we saw big changes, and that really isn't good for the tax rate. So we have trending now and that cyclical reassessment, so we get to see changes that are more reasonable every year. So then local budget preparation, that happens August through October, and that really is the process of going through the statutory process, developing your budgets, preparing revenue estimates, etc. So once those are loaded into the Indiana Gateway portal, then the DLGF certifies, they're responsible for certifying your budgets, so what you're allowed to spend, your property tax levies, and your tax rates. The tax rates are very important because the county needs those tax rates to calculate your tax bills. So in April, they'll send out tax bills. Those tax bills are due on May 10th and November 10th. And you will get distributions in June and December. Now this brings me to the point of why having cash reserves are so important. Because your primary revenue source is property tax, and you're only getting it twice a year, usually in most cases. So you really need to be able to have some reserves to operate that first 6 months before you get your tax draw. You do get other revenue streams, but that's your big revenue source. So at the local process, I'll go through this quickly. You know, you're required to have at least two meetings, a public hearing and adoption. You can have more. I know most counties I work with have several budget, we call them workshops or hearings, but the real hearing in the eyes of the state is the one where you allow taxpayer input, and maybe you do that at every hearing, but we just have to designate one as the official public hearing. And then of course you'll have an adoption meeting. Everything will be uploaded to Gateway. There is a notice to taxpayers, and if you remember, we used to have to advertise that in the newspaper. Now we're allowed to just post it in Gateway, but it has to be posted at least 10 days before the public hearing. So there is specific timing requirements, but just posting it in Gateway is all we need to do. You do have the option to also advertise it, but not many taxing units do that. You conduct the public hearing to receive taxpayer comment, you formally adopt the budget, submit the budget in Gateway. The next step then is the DLGF will review your budgets. They don't care what you're spending your money on. That's not their thing. That's state board of accounts. What they're looking at is, did you comply with the statute? Did you comply with the timing requirements? You have to have at least 10 days between your public hearing and adoption. Did you comply with that? And can you fund the budget within your maximum levy? So if you submit a budget, like many units do, that has a levy way above the max, they're going to bring it down. They're going to make sure you are at the maximum levy. And if you can't fund the budget with the revenues and the cash that you're showing on hand, then they're going to cut your budget. But they're not cutting it because they don't like what you're budgeting. They're going to cut it due to insufficient funds, or you didn't follow the statute. And that 1782 notice is very important because you only have 10 calendar days once received to review that. And usually it's the auditor's office that will review that. Once that 10 days expires, the DLGF will move forward to certify your final budget order. Once that budget order is certified, you cannot make any changes. So it is important to review that 1782 notice and request changes if needed. Now, since you are a county, you have the responsibility to review what we call binding review units. So there are certain units that require you to approve their budget. I think this is very odd. I can't remember when it was passed, maybe 5 or 6 years ago, maybe it's been longer, I lost track of time. But so any unit that has a non-elected board, such as an airport authority, or a fire protection district, or a solid waste district, or maybe even in some cases a library, depending on their budget, they have to come to you for approval of their budget. So you're adopting their budget. So they are required to have all their information in Gateway no later than September 1st so that you can do your binding adoption of their budget. But you're also responsible for doing what we call non-binding reviews. So, and I'm just gonna be honest, I think this is somewhat a waste of time because the DLGF gives you information to review and all it is the maximum levies and the circuit breakers, that's it. That's all you have to review. So what kind of a recommendation can you make based on that? I think it would be difficult if I was in your position, but that's what they give you. They tell you to review that. You have to do that no later than the first meeting in August. And then you provide a recommendation to all the units within your county. And they can just file that recommendation. They don't have to do whatever you are recommending. So I think the non-binding review really came about because, as I stated before, all the units within a taxing district are kind of in this together as far as circuit breaker. So this is a way for you to kind of keep tabs on what's happening out in the county. But still, it's kind of hard to see what's going on when all you get is maximum levy and circuit breaker. So anyway, that we still have that right now. I'm hoping at some point they'll take it out of the statute, but right now it is a requirement. So the budget process, and kind of brings me to my overarching reason, I think, for being here. So we help a number of counties in the state with their budget process, not only counties, but all taxing units. And we are trying to kind of change the way of thinking on the way you budget in a way. Because many taxing units do not start with revenues first. They just look at current year's budget and then build off of that, adding, you know, maybe a 2% increase to current year's budget or something like that. But really, we focus more on what we call zero-based budgeting, where we're starting with the estimated revenues for 2022 and we're building a budget based on that. Because if you could stay within your estimated revenues, you're going to have a balanced or better than balanced budget. So that's where we tend to start, is estimating those receipts. Then we develop the spending plans based on that. Now, if your current budget is very accurate and it's balanced, then you can use that. But oftentimes we see budgets that exceed the receipt. So you're starting off with an unbalanced budget and then compounding the situation if that's all you're using. So again, we start with the estimated funding sources, we develop our spending plans, we match those spending plans with the receipts. If they're greater than the receipts, then we try to look at why. If it's capital outlay, okay, that's fine if you have cash reserves to cover that. But if it's recurring cost, you might be getting yourself into a situation because you cannot year after year exceed the revenues you bring in because you'll be using cash reserves to fund that budget. And that's what we want to try to avoid. So moving on, what do we do when we're estimating revenues? Because we did do a revenue estimate for you, which I'll show towards the end. We look at actual historical receipts. Now, 2020 was a little bit different because we did have COVID, although luckily most counties did not see a huge decrease in revenue. In fact, gas taxes, we probably saw it the most. I will tell you that local income tax will likely decrease in 2022 because 2022 local income taxes are based on 2020 income tax returns. So we do estimate that will decrease. So this year we did look at 18, 19, and 20, and we made some adjustments. If 20 just looked like it was way off, we might have thrown out that year during our estimates. We use the information provided by DLGF when we get it. We haven't gotten anything yet. We also use the maximum levy growth factor, which we've currently estimated at 4.4%. That's not a certified number yet. And we also use the circuit breaker credits. So there's various different funding sources that you use to fund your budget. As I mentioned before, property tax is the primary, but local income tax is a pretty good funding source. And then you have motor vehicle and excise taxes. So when you go to the license branch and you register your vehicle or renew your plates, you're paying a vehicle excise tax. That's actually distributed to all taxing units within the county based on how much they're levying. So the more you levy in property tax, the more of this excise tax you will receive. So it's a good funding source. You have other state distributed. I mentioned gas taxes. That would be the motor vehicle highway and the local road street distributions. We did see a decline, but the traffic counts are back up, and you are nearly back up to your 2019 levels. So that's good news. Riverboat wagering, and then you don't get the cigarette tax. That's municipalities. And then you have all kinds of other local receipts. So that's just a kind of a flavor of what you would generate. So I put together this schedule in case you wonder what your makeup is of the revenue. This is for your entire county. So again, property tax, 53%. refunds and reimbursements, which could be a number of things, 9%, gas tax, other taxes. So you can see, as I stated, your property tax is your primary revenue source within this county. So now, into more specifics. So I really wanted you to see your receipts, how your receipts have come in over the last few years. And these are not for every fund in your county. We just picked out the major operating funds because those are the ones we are most concerned with, the funds where you have recurring costs. So if you look, for instance, at the general fund at the top, in 2019, your actual receipts were about 40.058 million. Your actual receipts in 2020 were higher, but included in that was about $5 million of CARES Act funding. So if we didn't have that, you know, you'd be closer to, you know, $40 million. In 2021, the receipts we're estimating right now is about $41 million. And in 2022, the estimated receipts are about $43 million for the general fund. The point of showing you this is to show you that your receipts really don't change that much from year to year, unless we have a big influx of revenue like a grant or CARES Act or ARPA monies. You can see for 2022, we're just estimating a change of about 3.9%. And, you know, that's not a whole lot. And, but that's not unusual. For your lit, I'm not going to go through everyone, but I do want to touch on lit, which is the next one. That's your economic development local income tax. I'm showing it's going to go down about 14.5%. So what we did there is we looked at unemployment over the past, well, since 2015. And we looked at how that impacted your local income tax through the year since 2015. So I know COVID was a little bit different, but you had some very high unemployment in April, May, June, and July of 2020. So did nearly every county in the state. And that's going to impact your local income tax distribution. Hopefully it won't go down by this much, but running that through our calculation is what we've determined at this point. Now, the LGF will come out with an estimate in July, but please know it will just be an estimate. They have historically been very, very conservative, so they may come out with an estimate that's 20% lower. I don't know at this point. So when you get that estimate, we'll just have to decide, you know, what's your comfort level with using that. The final LIT certification will not come in until October, towards the end of October. So that just kind of gives you a look at the revenues since 2019 and what we're estimating for 2021 and 2022 for all of these major operating funds. So moving on to this schedule that's, I'm sure, very hard to read, and I apologize, but so here's what we do for counties in the state that we work with. We tend to look at the 2020 actual expenditures, and we also look at the 2021 budgeted disbursements. So in this case, we used your budgeted disbursements because they were very close to your actual. There wasn't anything that looked too far off. So what we did is for each department said, okay, for the 4D program at the very top, what are they budgeting for 2021? They're budgeting $511,307. So what is that as a percentage of the total general fund budget? It is 1.18%. So we then apply that 1.18% to the estimated revenues for the entire general fund. So all we're doing is taking that estimated revenue amount and just allocating it to each of the departments. And that's really a place to start. It's not that the department, you know, can't spend more than this. It's just that this is a place to start to build your budgets. It's like a target budget. Now, you can see that every one of these are lower than what was budgeted in 2011. And I wish I would have included it on the schedule. If you look at 2020 actual disbursements, every one of these are higher than what was spent in 2020. So again, that's kind of what we do as a place to start. So here's what we do in other counties. We provide this target budget information, and we say, okay, department heads, complete your budget within these parameters, within this guideline. If you cannot fit within that guideline, then you would need to provide additional justification to the council. And what this tends to help with are those budget hearings or workshops that are all day long where departments are coming in and justifying line by line by line by line. This really is trying to kind of give the department heads the ability to manage their own budgets within parameters. Now again, this is a starting point because there's going to be departments that are going to need additional stuff that they haven't needed in the past. So then that's up for discussion. There are counties that we do this with that's cut down their budget workshop days with the department heads down from 4 days to just now one. So again, this is not a required method. This is just what we suggest or what we are used to doing. But it does help give the department heads an idea of, okay, where do I need to be when I'm preparing my budget? Does anybody have any questions about that? Because that's pretty important.
Yeah, I have a couple of questions.
Okay.
How many counties are you actually helping? 92 counties.
Yeah. So just me, I have to sit here, I have to think about it. I'm helping.
Oh, you don't have the number.
No. Yeah, I don't. Our team helps several counties.
Okay.
But I don't know right off the top of my head how many. I think I'm helping around five right now. just me personally.
So what I hear you saying is you're cutting down our time with spending with the departments. Is that what I'm hearing?
If you want to do that. Yeah, no, I'm saying that this process should cut down the time that you spend with departments. If you still want to go line by line and you think that's the most efficient use of your time, then by all means do that. I'm just saying that we've been approached by counties that have said, you know, is there a better way to do this? And that we feel like this is a better way to do it.
So instead of the auditor going to the department heads, figuring out they're helping them with their budgets, you do that.
No, they can, we're not taking that away from the county at all. All we're doing is providing you with the revenue estimates, the parameters, and then if you decide that you want to give direction to the department heads to prepare their line item budgets based on these parameters, then they would do that. We're not going to take away any sort of management by the county. That's not what we're here. We're financial advisors, so we're going to provide you with the numbers. That's what we do. And another value add that we can do is that when you get that time to where you're hashing out, well, this department needs some equipment, where can we pay for it? We can help you find options within your budget. Like maybe some things can be taken out of the Economic Development Fund. Maybe some things can be taken out of the Human Capital Development Fund. So we would help facilitate those discussions.
I have to ask that because one of my favorites starts out with 4-H projects. I just wanted to know how that all worked.
It's really however you want it to work. We're not trying to change anything here. We're just trying to help facilitate.
Give us figures.
Yes, a different way of looking at it, yeah.
Can I ask a question? And yeah. I might be skipping ahead, so if I am, just tell me to stop. But just curious, so you said this was one option. Are you giving us other options that the counties, other counties do as well as how they utilize
the counties,
you?
The counties that we're working with, they all use this option.
Okay.
Yeah, they use this option just as a starting point, and then we can build in raises if we can. Now, you know, here we've allocated, you do have a no department allocation at the very bottom. So if that wasn't there, then you may be able to increase the budget line item. So again, this is a place to start. But the counties we work with, this is how they do it. Because they don't want to micromanage every single line item. I sat through some of those meetings and we would be there 6 hours only to cut $1,000. Oh my goodness.
Yes, that's what we do.
Those are your favorite.
That was a lot of work for $1,000. So, but no, if you still want the department heads to come in and do that, that's fine. We're just here to help facilitate, and you know, we can provide whatever support that you need from us.
So these are our real numbers that you would be providing to us?
Yeah, these are the numbers as they stand now. Of course, as we get more information from the state, they could change, but right now, these are the numbers based on the current revenue projections. And what's driving this down is that local income tax.
So you guys normally take these numbers, you give them to the council. At that point, the council gives them to the department heads and says, hit this target.
Yes.
And
yes.
Then if they can't hit the target, then they come in, or they
yes,
still
they
come in?
No, well, that's
just what your past practice, or your
okay,
normal
so past
practice.
Practice is, we give this to the department heads and say, go ahead and fill out your line item budget. Don't put in any raises, just put in your current salaries, wages, and benefits, and the other items, you go ahead and put in what you need. Then they turn them in, and we match them up with these. And if it's outside the parameter, they need to justify why is it outside the parameter. And at that point, they would come in and do the budget workshop with you all, and we can try to figure out how to get those things funded. It doesn't mean they can't have a higher budget. It just means that we need to maybe try to find a different place because it won't fit into the general fund.
So then you finalize this, and then if there's raises, then you discuss them.
Then yes, if it's within the parameter or some are under the parameter, then we can try to build in the raise at that point.
What is your no department? Is that just a filler to
so
grab?
The no department is, we see this in every county, so it's usually disbursements that don't fit in with the department or just other disbursements. You guys seem to be pretty consistent. I have the historical with me, it's just not on the slide, where consistently you have some other disbursements. I didn't use it as a filler. I think I just kept it the same and applied the borough. So
what?
I don't know. Maybe,
Tony?
Maybe
what?
Yeah.
It's 17 T's usually.
Oh, like refunds.
17th.
And examination records and training with unaccompanied training. But those are both universal, so it's not really revenue, it's not really expenditure, it's a wash. I partially agree with you.
17 Ts, what? What?
Speaking English.
Okay, whenever there's an appeal of an assessed value and the taxpayer wins and we have to issue a tax refund check, it comes out of the general fund temporarily. And then at settlement time, we recoup what we essentially float to the other taxing units. So we recover everything except the county share of the refund. And then examination of records is our favorite, it's the audit.
Audit the auditor.
We pay for the auditor fees for all the towns.
Correct.
Townships and library and things that are missing.
Now, when we give money to like OE and Family Youth Service Bureau and Porter Stark, that doesn't come on here either?
Well, it's because it's not currently budgeted in the general fund.
Right.
That's why it's not shown above the.
Gotcha, okay.
This is general fund centric.
Yes, correct. Just because the other funds are separate and they have their own revenue streams and it's very easy to see the revenue. But here, we were just trying to find a method to divide it up amongst the departments.
I'm talking about registration of voters and it's zero. Is that voters' registration?
So see, here's a situation where you would need to make an adjustment. So if you need, so the 2021 budget currently is zero. Must have meant you didn't need a budget there. If you do need a budget, this is where.
No, voter registration's gone.
That's the change in the offices.
Yeah.
So that's why it looks like that.
It's all the elect, it should be up in.
I think it's under clerk.
Clerk and election board.
Oh, got it, got it, okay.
So this is kind of where, you know, we don't know what's going on internally, you know. So if you look through here and you say, oh, the county coroner, because there's so many autopsies, is gonna need at least $10,000 or $15,000 more in their budget, then we would have to make that adjustment. We, really the council, would need to make that adjustment, or the department head would need to make that adjustment. That's why I said this is a starting point only. Just to give you an idea of where the budget should be, if you want a balanced budget. If you, all of your budgets exceeded this, then you're gonna use cash reserves to fund your budget. And if that's what you wanna do, that's fine, but that's not a sustainable situation.
Don't we usually try to stay below that estimated receipts number?
That would be good, yes.
Because, I mean, the way you're budgeting it right now would be 100% of that estimated, and if we didn't get it, then we'd be short.
That's a very good point. So in the past, I looked at your history, typically you budget at or above your revenues, but you don't spend that. So you add to your cash reserves, which is great. So yes, I mean, this is budgeting 100% of your revenues, so yeah, that's a good point. If you wanna add to your cash reserves, although your cash reserves are pretty good, if you wanna add to your cash reserves, then you would go below. Right now, your budget, and I don't know if I have that with me, but your budget as it stands now, based on 2021 estimated receipts, would utilize over $1 million of your cash reserves as budgeted now. That doesn't mean you're gonna spend it all, because in the past, you haven't.
Right.
But.
Kinda like the habit reserve.
Yeah, so that's just what I'm saying. I mean, it depends on how you wanna budget. I would say don't budget above your cash, and you can budget below. And having a contingency, like I work with one county, and they had me take out $300,000 as a contingency right off the top for raises. I didn't do that here, because I don't know what the pleasure of the council is. I just, this is an example and a place to start. But that's typically, you know, that's the procedure.
So maybe before we get these numbers, we would wanna discuss potentially lowering them a little bit before giving them out to department heads? I don't know. Isn't that, Vicky, don't you normally keep us, when we budget in the past, I know you were always very strict on those numbers, and wasn't it lower than the estimated normally? Or is it right to it?
Well, we take into account a lot of other factors, and we do prepare the revenue estimates, and it's based on the history. And so we tell you what we believe we would be able to grow the general fund budget within the levy limitation. but I have to balance that with the other property tax funds, the other property tax controlled funds. So that takes into account the other impacts from the other funds. So yes.
So I would think you would need to be involved in that number.
The challenge for you, and Paige alluded to it, and thank you for bringing that up, because a big issue that you're going to see is on paper, you're going to see larger cash reserves than what we normally should see. And that's because last year, at the end of December, we got the $4.2 million deposit into the general fund from the CARES Act. Now, the total CARES Act reimbursement was a little bit higher. But at the end of the year, and it affected the December 31st cash balance of the general fund. So it, when you look at our financial report, you'll see that we ended in the general fund with a cash balance of about $10 million. So we're finally getting back to where we were back in about 2009, 2010. However, that includes the 4.2 CARES Act. So if you cut that off, if you just pretend it wasn't there, and let's say maybe you decided to put in a rainy day fund instead, we would have had a cash balance of about $6 million, which was a decline from the prior year. So you are starting to see it go down. So we do have this little bit of a cushion because of the CARES Act reimbursement. But the challenge is going to be how far you want to stretch that out.
But I think, Andy, to your question, we normally, based upon the auditor's recommendation, budget to what we believe the receipts would be.
Thank you.
The cash balances, the estimated additional appropriations.
Whatever the number Vicki says is our estimated total, is what you guys normally budget to. That's all I'm saying.
And I always thought she was conservative on that number. I mean, it's been a few years since I've been on it.
Yeah, and it's worked.
And I agree. That's what I want to make sure. Yeah. Before you tell the department heads, hey, this is the number, and then you come back to me, the real number's a little lower.
Right.
That's what I was asking. So yeah. I'm sorry to get there.
But are these numbers based on that $5 million we put into from the other fund, the hospital fund?
No. And just general fund.
Yes.
You got to scrape all those other funds out for a second. This is just general fund.
And the department's head, don't they meet with you, Vicki, or they turn their budget in to you?
No, they turn them into the council.
To the council.
But actually, ever since we went to the new system, it's all digital now. We don't have to have as much paperwork going. So they just enter their budget straight into the system, and it's nice for them to do that. They usually turn in their explanation letters to your office.
Okay.
And Joy gives us a copy.
So moving on, so again, we've kind of already been through this. We want to try to maintain your cash reserves, absolutely. We want to make sure that your reserves are no less than 15% of your disbursements. So that's the floor. So really you want to be around 20 to 25%. And we are working on your comprehensive financial plan right now, so I don't know exactly what that reserve level is right now off the top of my head, but we are working through your comprehensive financial plan, so we'll be able to tell you that. But Vicki brought up a very good point. You've got a temporary bump in your cash reserve. You're not gonna expect that every year.
So what's 6 million of 40? Who's quick with math? What percentage are we at right now? Yeah.
I don't know.
You mean of the CARES?
15%. No. What's 15% of 40 million?
Okay. Well. Okay. With or without the.
So we're at 15% right now, basically.
I think he said without.
Last year
without.
We definitely met the. My goal is 20%, but
good.
I thank you for saying 25. My goal is now 25 for the general fund because it's so important to have those cash reserves. But we have the gold standard, is it still considered the gold standard, is 15% is the minimum. And we exceeded that in, 2020. But then this year, it depends on whether you look at it with or without the CARES Act reimbursement.
20%.
That's wonderful that we're at that, at that point.
And $40 million at 20% is for round numbers, around $8 million. So, kind of the.
So without CARES Act, it was $6 million at the start of this year. With it was 10. So it depends on how you want to look at it.
Well, the CARES Act's there, right?
It's there now.
General fund?
It is.
I mean, so that's all, it's, there's no plan for it to move anywhere. So at this point, it's good. We're 20, we're more than 20.
That's what I said.
Currently, for right now.
So this next slide is just, now I'm showing the rest of the major operating funds. And I'm just showing you some historical information. So in 2015, the first column is your actual receipts, what you received in. 2019 are your actual disbursements. So you had a nearly balanced budget, if you look at what you spent. In 2019, you added to your cash reserves of $81,580. So that was good. Your, I think your budget was a little bit higher than that, but you underspent and you were net cash flow good. But these other funds where they're red, that just simply means you did utilize cash reserves. Now, there may be a good reason. There could have been capital items. But what we're trying to avoid is that a recurring budget that has salaries and wages and things that you pay for every year, you really need to stay within those receipt guidelines. Because if you don't, you can see you start chewing down your cash reserves. And that's really the whole point of all of this, is just to try to stay within those receipts. 2020, you can see the comparison there. Again, as Vicki mentioned, look, your general fund, wow, you got a net cash flow of $3.5 million. But again, that, the CARES Act money is in there. But you can see some of these other funds, highway. It's very difficult in highway because you have to put 50% of your state distribution in the regular highway fund and then 50% in the restricted. I'm seeing this in nearly every county. It's difficult. Most counties are burning down their cash reserves in their regular fund because they're so restricted on the other side. So that's where we're at right now. There was a piece of legislation that we were hoping would pass, and it did not, to change that so that you could put 60% in your regular fund and 40% in the restricted. It didn't pass. And it was also going to allow you to use restricted monies for snow removal and things of that nature. That didn't pass either. So we're still kind of stuck with that because you can't use property tax to fund highway operations. Counties cannot. So you're stuck with the gas tax, basically. You get a little bit of other license permits, like street cut permits, but other than that, you're pretty much stuck. So you can see what happened with the other funds there. I mean, all in all, it looks pretty good. But again, just trying to stay within those receipt parameters. Now, 2021 doesn't look that great, but first, I do want to tell you that we are notoriously conservative. We don't want to overestimate your revenue. So hopefully, we're conservative here. And we appreciate any input from the auditor's office. But currently, the general fund, as budgeted, if you were to spend all of that, and again, historically, you have not, but if you would spend all of that, you would utilize $1.4 million of your cash reserves. That's what that means. So you can see highway fund, that's a pretty big chunk, but it's offset maybe potentially by the restricted. There may be some things that you can move over to restricted. And a lot of counties wait towards the end of the year to see what they can move over to restricted. But you can see the other ones there. If you were to spend every dollar of your budget, that's kind of where it would be. So moving on, I already talked about this. I don't want to go through it again. Just the state review of the budgets. I think the most important thing you need to know is that preliminary budget that's sent to you, usually in November, December, and having that 10 calendar days to respond. Usually, the auditor's office takes care of that. But once that's over, you can't ask for any more changes. And just in case, I don't know how many of you are familiar with your budget order from DLGF, but this is what it looks like. It's two pages. It continues on the next page. But this outlines each of your DLGF approved funds. You've got many more funds. They just aren't approved by DLGF. But these are each of your DLGF approved funds. your certified budget, so that's the maximum you can spend in each of these funds unless you do an additional appropriation. And just remember that additional appropriations are above and beyond your budget, and if you currently have a balanced budget, those additional appropriations are going to come out of your cash reserves. So when you approve additionals, remember that. It's coming. You should
remember that, please. Remember that.
Remember.
You always let us know that.
Additional is not a good word.
Well,
I say additional means you're going over budget.
Yes.
That's right.
That's exactly
it's
right.
Additional.
Try to.
That grows the blood from the trees.
It does not.
By compartments.
Completely agree.
Where's the sheriff at? Is he here?
Oh, we have it.
So I'm interested in figuring out, going back, that 1.4, you know, the general fund that you say if we spent everything we've budgeted, the net cash flow will be a negative $1.4 million, to identify where that is actually at.
Right, so these are, what I'm going to say again, probably conservative revenue estimates, what we provided this information to the community. She probably hasn't had a chance to really look at it because I just gave it to her. So, but yeah, if Vicki sees something that maybe we're too conservative on, then, you know, we can update these numbers. So, I mean, it sounds like she's been doing a good job of providing revenue estimates, so her input is necessary in this process.
Is that 2021 disbursement just carrying over? I mean, that's what we're current. Where is the disbursement coming from?
That's your certification.
Okay.
So it matches your budget order exactly. So guess what? This doesn't include any additionals if you approved any additionals. But it matches your budget order exactly.
Okay.
42, yeah. That's what you have permission to spend.
And so, and Vicki, I'm not going to use the terms of art correct, but I'm assuming for a moment that our 2021 receipts are looking lower because of some of that other, the revenue that's estimated coming in has not been what it would be. Because I think what Jeremy's asking is that we felt like we passed a balanced budget in 2021. How could it be 1.4 behind?
Correct.
Bottom line question is asked.
Yes. Where is this 1.4 in the red popping up? I mean, yeah, we felt like, you know, we were given that growth factor. I think we even talked about staying underneath that. We didn't even budget everything we thought we could grow. But now I'm being showed a number. If we spent everything that we budgeted, we're going to be in the red $1.4 million.
No. That's cash flow.
Yeah, that's cash flow.
That's eating into any kind of reserves. And the estimated receipts, that's your page, that's your estimates.
That's
of what's going on.
Yeah, I want to say something real quick, and then I'm sorry for interrupting, Vicki, but you know, last year, that was a whole year ago when those revenue estimates were created. We have new information now. So this is an updated, and that happens. We get updates. So yes, this is a Baker Tilly revenue estimate, probably conservative, but we did look at historical data. It doesn't mean that you can't fund that budget, it just means you'll use cash reserves to fund the budget if these revenue estimates are
as an example of the revenue estimates. It kind of shocked us all last year when the DLGF issued the MVH estimates, and we had to use those estimates. And, you know, I'm as conservative as they come fiscally, and I felt that those were way too low, and we had to cut the MVH budget accordingly. But so far this year, we are already at pre-COVID levels with the gas tax. So those estimates are off, and we went in and we revised the revenue estimates for the MVH fund. Now, that doesn't solve the ridiculous problem with MVH restricted, but that problem is going to be here until we get that law changed.
So I think, Jeremy, too, if I have the same question you have, I think what we need is, Vicky has the opportunity to tell us what she thought or what she thinks our 2021 estimated receipts are as we now are sitting in 2021. And then that will tell us whether or not we are eating into our cash reserves. Because I know we're going to get, I don't want everyone to get lost in the concept of net cash flow versus just a plain out question, do we have $100 to spend $110? Because if it's a cash flow problem, that's slightly different than eating into the revenue permanently.
The riverboat money, I thought.
Yeah, so I can talk about that.
Probably additional.
Well, what question did you have about that?
Well, I thought those were, it's income, but it looks like it's not, because we're down 1,500.
Well, I mean, it's a nearly balanced budget. You get a set amount every year. It's 405,712. Your budget is
400.
I mean, it's nearly balanced.
Yeah, but what are we dispersing with the riverboat money that went up 2,000? Is it? Am I looking at this wrong?
Well, no. I think you're looking at the 2021 budgeted disbursements.
Mm-hmm.
That's if they all got spent. And right now, the revenue projection or the estimated receipts is lower. That may be because as we are now in June and have a better idea of what's happening with the riverboat money, that estimate it may have just have come down. So when we were talking about MVH, that money's coming monthly. So every month they're getting a check. And so they're knowing what that numbers are and how it's projecting and how it's looking. Mm-hmm. So that's why Vicky can say, hey, look, now those numbers are coming back pre-COVID. She's looking at May, you know, April, May, June. She's looking at those, comparing them back to those monthly amounts we were receiving in 2018 and 2019 and saying they've recovered. Well, now we're looking at, in June, we're looking at the revenue, the receipt estimate for Riverboat, and it's just slightly lower, and it's some of it's timing. Because everybody was sitting almost a year ago here, give or take, with an estimate, and we budgeted to the estimate. And I agree with Paige, you know, getting within $2,000 of that number is, you're threading the needle. And I agree with, I think Jeremy made a comment that I'm not sure everybody heard, some of that 1.4 million net cash flow may be, like I don't know what the total is so far, but if we've done $400,000 of additional so far in 2021, that's on that 1.4 number. Now, if we've only done $20,000 of additionals, that changes that number a bit.
Yeah, so there aren't any additional appropriations here. So if you had 400,000, then you would be at 1.8 million negative.
Oh, that's not possible.
I'm not sure.
Do you know what?
How are we?
Not offhand.
Offhand.
But
we could look.
I know we've kept it to a minimum this year. No.
That might be changing very soon.
Huh?
Yeah, we'll give you an up to date. We don't have access right now to.
What will be changing? That was scary.
Well, did you look at your
amended agenda?
Oh.
Vicky, is there a way that you could maybe get us the last, like, 5 years of across-the-board raises, percentage-wise?
I can tell you pretty much right now.
What, each year?
Uh-huh. This, let me write it down so I have it. It's see how good I am, Tiffany. Okay, 2021 was 3% across the board. Keep in mind that there were some variations. Certain departments got...
That's across the board, yeah, what we gave every... Yeah.
Okay, so in 2020, it was also 3%. 2019, it was 4%. 2018, it was 4%. No, 1,500 across the board.
Oh, that was a flat amount in 15?
Yes. And in 2017, I believe it was also 15.
1,500 across a flat rate too?
It was either 1,000 or 15. We could look that up for you.
For 7 years, we didn't get...
You wouldn't have any idea what 1,500 those years is, matches up to be, roughly 2%, 3%. I know.
It's different on everyone's salary, right?
Roughly.
Depending on what they make.
So.
Yeah, the jury's looking for the total. So the total of last year's raise was 750,000, and the 1,500 is that 500,000, 200,000, or a million. That's, I think, what
that's. Just look, yeah. I mean, those are.
No, it's a good question. That's a good one.
But 1,500 for what, 600 people?
About
750.
Yeah.
I think. Just interesting.
I really enjoyed this. It's very informative.
So, we've done pretty good so far. But I definitely want to dig into this 14. I'm just not understanding that that 1.4 million completely.
And I think
well, that money.
And I think, in fairness, I think what it means is that Vicki needs to look at that estimated receipt and see whether or not she agrees with that number. Because we're at such a small percentage difference, and I'm going to hedge a guess that that's about 3.5% difference. And you're dealing with 41 to 42.5, give or take. And so it's not that large of a percentage difference, is my point. So. If the receipts, if the 2021 estimated receipts are slightly more conservative or not, that's going to change that number greatly.
The receipts are down. The receipts are down, aren't they?
Well, I mean, your receipts are down from 2020 actual primarily because of the CARES Act money. You don't have that, obviously. But those receipts are tracking along pretty good because if we just throw off that CARES Act money in 2020, I think your receipts would have been around 41 or maybe. So I mean it's higher than, you know, if we just forget about CARES Act. I mean, it looks very reasonable to me based on the previous receipts.
I don't see why our net cash flow could be that.
Now one thing too, is there any capital in your budget? Because capital, it's okay to have a net cash flow negative if you're going to take the capital out of your cash reserves. If that's what you want to do, then, you know, so I can't remember how much capital you have budgeted in the general fund. If it were 1.4 million, then you're basically using cash reserves to fund capital. I think where we're going to have a concern is that these are all recurring costs, but I would think that you have some capital budgeted in there. I don't know. I don't have the detail with me.
Peter, are you talking about capital assets?
Capital, okay.
Outlays, yeah.
I just wanted to clarify if that was like paying down principal or whatever.
No.
One of the issues is we have a lot of capital outlays that are not budgeted in the 4000 series. They're intermingled and contractual. So sometimes it's difficult even for us to know what's a capital asset and what's not, because it's tied in with contractual, and it's perfectly fine to pay it out of contractual. But if you are trying to pinpoint capital for either budgeting purposes or for something like, say, a GAAP financial report, departments don't want us to keep hounding them to please give us your capital asset listing, and they don't give us an accurate one, and we have an idea of what they spent capital-wise. It can be difficult. It can be very difficult.
So basically, just to summarize, there could be some non-recurring costs buried within those line items.
And I can, the stormwater fund, I guarantee has some.
Yeah,
I would imagine. Yeah. I mean, I think we're, on purpose, this is not a reverting fund, the money to go do these projects. So their budget will at times look as if it's over budgeted, but it's been saved to go do those capital projects. So that's why the information is wonderful. It's just now it's understanding how to interpret it correctly. But, you know, Vicki knows that, I don't know if it's CCD or cable off the top of my head, but for several years, that fund does not have enough in its cash reserve. I think it's...
CCD was in real, real trouble a couple years ago. And as Paige mentioned, there's a way you can reallocate levy. And so that's what we did with CCD, because we knew that fund could not, it kept getting cut by the state, and we knew the fund could not sustain itself. So you guys approved the general fund budget, but we were able to reallocate some of the levy. Now the CCD fund is stable. It's very stabilized compared to what it used to be.
Yeah, and it probably needs additional work. It went from red alert to...
Oh, gosh.
Do something now that probably still needs to be capable of to get it back to where it needs to be. But this is the process to allow us to get to those other funds. Lit obviously is looking like it's going to have potentially a 15% cut. So we got to dig into those numbers. That was on another slide to see what that dip's going to look like. And then what the cash reserves are in there, and what capital items or other items are within that lit budget that can be taken out or not taken out.
When do you anticipate having that the financial plan that will include the capital in it?
So we are probably maybe 2 or 3 weeks out. We're pretty nearly done with the draft. But once I get the draft, I want to meet with Vicki and whomever you want to have on kind of just a small meeting just to walk through and see if we're missing anything. But we're pretty close.
Yeah, okay, for sure. Definitely want to meet with some of the council members to...
And that's going to be, really, that's going to give you a good illustration of where you're at, where you've been, and where you're at. This is just a small little snapshot. It's hard to see, but you're going to have cash flow schedules for all of your major funds with historicals, like actual, and then we're going forward like 3 years. That's going to really be, because you're going to see detail line items of the revenues.
So I'm looking at page 33, where it says the estimated revenues for 2020 at 42.6. And yeah, so and the change is 3.9, and you say that you think that the growth will be 4.4. So is that, I mean, you're doing that to be just be conservative?
So the 4.4 was the growth on the maximum levy, but you're hit with circuit breakers. So that drops it down. And this is not just property tax, it's everything within that fund. But remember, your circuit breakers are part of that estimate. So there again, I go back to circuit breakers. You know, it's good that we're getting 4.4% growth, maybe. That's just an estimate. That's the highest it's been in many years, but that's not what you're going to receive. You're losing 4.5% due to service. 4.5% of what you value is lost.
Going back to, so I'm just real looking at 2021. Disbursements, the page 38, but keeping in mind page 33, the estimated receipts of 42 million, 4.26. For 2022, but the 2021, I mean, I'm just looking at, so there's not a whole lot of growth if I'm looking at.
That's was kind of the point of one of my slides, is that I said, you really, and you're just like every other governmental unit in the state, there's not a lot of growth from year to year, unfortunately. The growth you get for the most part is property tax. Because your revenues, like your local revenues, unless you increase your charges for services, there's virtually no growth. That's why it's so difficult to budget for local government, at least here in this state, because costs are usually growing by a faster rate than these maximum levy growth thresholds.
Are we maxed out on our levy?
Yes, you are.
So, and that's a good point. What is excess levy? How do, I mean...
Excess levy? So are you talking about like an excess levy appeal?
Yes.
Okay, so yes, there is a way that you can request a levy appeal to increase your overall maximum levy, but there's only four or five reasons why you can do that. One is if your assessed value is growing at a rapid rate. And we check that as part of your comprehensive financial plan. We just check that and you do not qualify. You haven't had enough growth because your growth in assessed value over the last 3 years has to be 2% greater than the average statewide growth. Well, the average statewide growth is, I think, about 2.5%. Well, your average growth is, I think, 2 or 3%. So it's not, you don't qualify for that. Another appeal is annexation. You don't qualify for that. You're not a municipality. Another one is a disaster appeal. I don't want you to qualify for that. And then correction of error, that's just temporary. So there used to be 14 appeals in the statute. It's down to like 4 or 5 now. So we did check your qualification for an appeal. Now, occasionally you could be qualified for a shortfall appeal, but that's just temporary. And that would be if, you talked about those 17 T's, if you issued a bunch of taxpayer refunds, you could temporarily increase your levy for 1 year to recoup that, but it's temporary. So there's not a lot, but, okay, so if we're looking for additional revenue, what's your options? Local income tax.
I don't like where this meeting's going at all.
So.
Or increasing your Q capital development fund to the max, you're nearly at the max now. So, you've already exercised that option.
As Jeremy said before, no new taxes. He said it, not I don't know.
Well.
I don't think I've ever ran on that, Andy. Yeah.
So with more houses being built, that doesn't really give us that much?
No. So houses and new development can help lower your tax rate, but it's not going to give you any more maximum levy. But if it lowers the tax rate, it could have a positive influence, hopefully, on your circuit breaker. So it could potentially give you a little more property tax in that way. But because you're kind of competing with all the other taxing units, so what if your tax rate did go down, but the school added another tax rate? Well, then your circuit breaker's still going to go up. And I'm not picking on the school. It could have been the library, it could have been the township, whatever.
Okay.
There's just not a lot of ways to generate new revenue for local government.
How would you say that our county is doing financially?
I think you have some strong cash reserves, yeah. I mean, I'm not here because you're in trouble. I think I'm just here just to sort of help you through the budget process and maybe look at things a little bit differently and show you.
Thank you, that's what I'd like to hear.
Okay, I'm not here because I think there's a problem, or I don't think that's why I'm here. I think I'm here just to maybe give another perspective.
Mm-hmm.
And the long-term comprehensive financial plan that we're working on is going to help you plan out into the future, especially with your capital plans.
Okay. All right. So I know usually we send a letter out, Joy, to the departments. When is it? July? Sometime in July?
It's changed. usually it's around July. I think last year it was later July.
It was August 3rd. So, okay. So we have to, as a council, kind of come up with an idea how we want to approach, how we're going to.
Yes, departments have already started asking about it, and that just takes up time in our office and Joy's room.
Mm-hmm.
So, if you could, yes, just at least make a project, just to let the departments know.
Isn't there always kind of like a problem in finally getting the final one in? I think.
Oh yeah. There's always some
better. The better, the quicker the final.
Okay, council members, you asked about additional appropriations in just the general fund, right?
Correct.
So far this year, to date, it's been $72,320. But then we have on your next council, it would boost it. It would boost it.
Additional.
This is an additional
158,
651 pending. So total, that would bring it.
That doesn't include the 28 that should be.
Yeah, the sheriff pulled off 28.
That was 158 net back.
So that's 158 without what the sheriff was asking?
Correct.
He asked for $28,000 for the DOC budget. He pulled that off.
Okay.
He still spent two requests, two overtime budgets for jail and sheriff's office.
So going back to page 34, page, yeah. I mean, so this is your estimated revenue on the right-hand side, right?
Right.
And you're just using the same exact percentage that each department is using right now?
Yeah, I'm basically just saying, okay, I looked at the 2021 budget and figured out what percentage of the total general fund that budget was and just applied that percentage to the estimated receipts. So I'm just basically allocating receipts to each department. That's really all that I'm doing. I will provide details of it, but more details of it. So she can have it for us. There's not no detail here. Like, line item detail of our revenue estimates and our assumptions, and if something sticks out, she can certainly offer it. We can have that discussion. But I like to hear that she's ultra conservative because I'm quite conservative. I'd rather not overestimate revenues.
Now, do you give recommendations to certain departments as to where maybe they're spending a little bit too much, like?
No, we don't, because that's really a management decision. We like to see departments take control of their own budget. So if we say, hey, you've got $500,000 to spend, and you know how to operate your department, you know what you need, then go ahead and operate.
But here's your number.
Yeah, here's your number.
Sure.
And that kind of avoids the line by line by line, why do you need this copy paper or whatever. We shouldn't be micromanaging. I mean, that's just my opinion.
That's what we'll have to wrestle.
It's the bigger items, the extraordinary items, like, oh, I need this vehicle. Well, that's something additional. So tell us why you need that vehicle. And maybe that comes out of CCD fund instead of general.
That's what I was going to get to. You know, Sylvia's point is this is just, these are general fund. So,
yeah.
I mean, if we were to approach it like this, just because, you know, you see a lot of numbers that, you know, I think you were just saying the sheriff's going to have to cut, but the sheriff's got about 120 other budgets that he could use to fill, you know, any voice. It is.
Are they only looking at general fund, or are they going into the other budgets?
No, I'll provide this. When I get back to the office, I will email you the rest. I have the rest of the funds with the estimated receipts. So when I say rest of the funds, not every single fund you budget, this would be the major funds. Mm-hmm. I will provide that via email. It's really hard to see in the, so it doesn't give you all the information. So I'll provide that via email.
I'm just going to say, I think this is very good information.
Okay.
Just speaking for myself, and you know, I believe wholeheartedly in letting department heads run their departments, and a big part of that is managing their budget. You know, being a freshman county councilman, but I have sat through being a county employee through our budget process through the county, and no offense to my fellow councilmen, it's torture. And I think that we have room for improvement.
Mm-hmm.
I think this is a very good start for us, and I appreciate the information.
Yeah, to reiterate Mike's point, this was designed to be kind of budget workshop 101. And you know, first things first, great starting point. I think it was informative for all of us, new and even more. You know, more experienced. I think it's clear that the county is in a strong, I mean, we're convinced, and hopefully you agree, we're in a very strong financial position, which would be the envy of most other counties throughout the state of Indiana. And I think that's in large part because we have taken such a conservative approach to the budget process.
And you have a very strong county auditor.
and
She's known throughout the state for being a very strong
Could not agree with you more on that. And so I think this is a great start to it. I think internally we've got some, you know, decisions to make in terms of how we want to approach the budgeting process, and with Baker Tilly's help, you know, in terms of coming up with these figures, you know, it makes simple sense to look at whatever page is up on the screen. We've got 2021 budget disbursements, and we're looking at what that will look like in 2022 based on estimates. If you throw in 2020's actual as a comparison to give us, you know, a clear picture of it, it is helpful to the departments to say this is the target for the department, and we're not as concerned about the line by line item. We're looking at that big number, and somehow some way you're going to have to work within that big number, and you work that out yourself. And because I think there's a significant amount of opportunity for streamlining the budgeting process, and I've been a part of it, and I definitely agree that there should be a easier, less painful, more productive way of going through this process year after year. And lastly, I think that the help that Baker Tilly is going to provide in terms of a spending plan, I mean, I think we have taken a look at this on a year-by-year basis historically, or what did we do last year, what are we going to do this year. But as we take that out over the course of 5 years, let's say, to say, this is what we're doing now, this is what we're doing 5 years from now, this is what our spending plan will be over the course of 5 years, which we haven't talked beyond the next year on spending. And when we start talking about you know, capital outlays and so forth, I mean, you have to have a plan. And then you have a document, you know, a five-year plan. And it's not to say it's set in stone, but it's certainly the guidebook, the playbook. And then you look at it, and when a department comes up and says, we need this for, didn't plan on it, but this is an unexpected capital outlay, can we do it? And we'll say, was this in your plan that you helped create? And if it wasn't, then it's going to be difficult to let that happen unless we can work some other arrangements out. But to have that plan for the next 5 years, to anticipate what the revenue is going to be, anticipate what the spending is going to be, have that capital spending plan out there, just makes life easier for everybody. And so I think it makes perfect sense. And Paige, you did a wonderful job of explaining, you know, the basics of budgeting, which are not, it's not easy to understand clearly with all the different funds and all the different revenue streams and so forth. It's not an easy thing to sort through. So I think the information you provided tonight certainly provided some additional clarity for us. And we're definitely looking forward to working with Baker Tilly as we work through the next steps. So I think it's a great, certainly a great day for Porter County's financing.
You know, I do want to agree with Mike, or Councilman Brickner, when he said it is torture for the department heads, and this will give the department heads more of an idea of this is your, you know, the figure that you're going to have to work with and come up with, and it might take some of that anxiety and angst out of sitting in front of us, because we know that this is kind of what we've got to get to. So it might lessen that blow for them, where they're going to have to stay within that thing and verify why if they can't want.
So I would appreciate if maybe when you get that rough draft, if maybe we can meet in two blocks. You know, right now we're you know, maybe three at a time, and go over that so everybody's got some input into that. That'd be great. Anybody else got anything?
Thank you.
That said, and yeah, if you could pass that information along with that, and then we'll. Okay, and then we'll be in touch. Sir, anybody have anything else? No? So, all right, we'll be Vicky, Tony, Tiffany, anything to add? No? Thank you. All right. Thank you very much.
There's no hammer. We can't leave.
Don't need a motion.
Let it be written.
Let it be written.
Baker Tilly from?
Yeah, somewhere in the round.